Hello and welcome back. If you follow the channel, you know that we recently opened the Soyuz navigation computer, better known as the Globus. Inside, we found an amazing analog computer powered by lots of gears and a very little bit of electronics. This oddly anachronistic yet magnificent instrument was used until 2002 in the Soyuz-T and Soyuz-TM capsule. Unfortunately, it was badly banged up, probably from a drop. The globe was stuck and the mechanical front controls did not work. We quickly traced that to the globe supporting shaft, which had been dislodged by the fall. We carefully removed the globe to see if we could repair it. From the globe markings, which included NASA tracking stations, we are pretty certain that this Globus was assigned to the Apollo-Soyuz rendezvous flight in 1975, which jives well with the shown location of the Vanguard tracking ship and the 1973 date codes on its components. We don't know if we have the one that flew, or a backup one, or one that was meant for the flight but was set aside after a big fall. Fortunately, we were able to reinsert the shaft after deburring its slightly damaged bearing. That freed up the controls and we were able to move the globe manually. In the last episode, we explained what the controls and indicators do, the orbit position and longitude adjustments, the orbit time adjustments, the orbit indicator, the landing angle adjustment, the latitude and longitude indicators, the light shadow indicator, and the landing position light. But you know us, we don't tear things down, quite the contrary. We reverse engineer them, repair them, and make them work as they were intended to. However, an obstacle stood in our way. Most of the electrical wires had been cut off, which is quite puzzling since the unit had a tamper-proof seal on one of its screws. So cutting the wires was both intentional and official, maybe to prevent the further use of the device after its big fall. But a whole bunch of cut wires is nothing that Master Ken cannot reverse engineer when he has his Google lab coat on. Heck, he can reverse engineer an Intel 8086 chip by just looking at its transistors. So a few cut wires was just a little extra challenge. So Ken, we are ready to
attempt to power up.
I've traced the wiring through and I figure the two solenoids are wired to these pins, and so when we put pulses in here, it should make the globe rotate.
And I want it all out and put my HP equipment in good service. We have 1 second. Pulses driving a little pulsar and then being amplified to 28 volts.
27.
If I just press the button, that should be it.
Oh, it's clicking.
I hear clicking.
I don't see any motion, but I guess motion is very slow. You have to wait a day. Clicky rotates is for the Earth's rotation. One clicky is for the spacecraft's rotation.
Okay.
So the other clicky is underneath there.
I can't see it clicking.
Yeah, it's clicking.
I think we should turn it around and I should make
a time lapse
of it. All right. But we're flying, apparently.
Yeah.
Do you see it moving, Master Ken?
Yes, we see it moving. We launched from Baikonur, the number 7 here.
Uh-huh.
And now you can see we're a few millimeters past the 7. And we've set it to an exactly 90-minute period. So it should complete a full orbit in 90 minutes. Of course, by that time, the Earth will have rotated, so it won't go back over Baikonur. It will be over a different point.
Oh yeah, it's moving. Yeah, yeah. We started at the 7, right?
Yeah.
Okay, let's see if I can.
So our spacecraft is really cruising along.
Alright, the Globus is working. This is what it looks like sped up by a factor of 8.
Should we try overclocking it?
Yeah, so it's moving so slow.
The idea is that can we overclock the thing?
And I can do 5 hertz. There we go. Now it's moving. Okay, and then if I make the pulse a little smaller. I can get it to go faster. Should I go 10 hertz?
Doesn't sound like a good factor.
Overclock! No, that's too fast. Yeah, here we go.
Yeah, now it's visibly moving.
Here you can watch the orbit fine time correction reset as we explained in the previous episode. The arm will jump back to zero without disturbing the mechanism, thanks to the friction clutch.
Point. Just snap back.
Now if we speed it up by a factor of 10, this is a total speed up of 80. However, as we were admiring the spinning globe, we realized that something was not quite right. Can you spot what is wrong? Let me show you. Let's first freeze frame as we fly over the equator. The latitude on the left shows zero, as it should, and the longitude indication on the top says 180, closely matching the location on the globe. Let's keep on going for a little more. Alright, now we are at 240 degrees east on the globe, but the longitude indicator scale says 247. It's a little off, but not too bad, so let's fly some more. Now we are really off. We are at 315 degree longitude on the globe, but the indication is 282 on the scale. Meanwhile, latitude is still correct. It eventually gets much better here, though we are still a few degrees off. Have you guessed what's causing this?
While we were rotating the globe, we discovered that the indication in longitude is not properly timed. It's time that's some height in the globe it's okay, at some other height during the orbit it's not okay, and the reason is that there is a correction for it that has to be timed with the correct latitude. When you're flying at 51 degrees, you should put the equator. So here's your equator. So the Earth spins this way, but you spin around here, right? You go woo. If you were flying along the equator, the longitude indicated on the globe would be the same as the longitude you are flying. But since you are flying at an angle, the longitude indicator has to be corrected. And you have to subtract a correction and then add it back on so that when you are here, you have zero correction. And when you're over there, you have subtracted something. And to do that, they do use this specially calculated cam plus a differential mechanism that adds the 0 to 360 to it. So that's the adjustment cam for the reading here. So it takes the rotation of the Earth then through this differential, there's a differential somewhere, that adds this correction, and so you get the correct longitudinal reading while you are moving up and down the Earth, which will push you ahead and behind. So previously what I had just done is move this thing so it was correct into one position, but that's not enough because then it's not in sync with this one. So I should ignore this and make sure the correction is done properly and then adjust it. There we go. There is a cam adjustment here, but
The indication is read directly from the cam, so as long as this is timed to this, I should be good on latitude. So now this is the one that's wrong. Can I turn it around? Yes, I can. That's equator, roughly. So now I am on the max of the timing cam and on the equator. Is there a way that I can test? Okay. So I have to do that again. So we finally got it right, and this is Antoine's diagrams. These are mine. We got confused so many times. First, we saw marks. There's clearly a mark over here. And then we say, okay, fine. We have to align the mark over here. And when that timing mark is aligned, then we have another timing mark over here. There we go. And when this other timing mark is here, they should be in time and everything will be fine. And then we try that, and the longitude indication was completely wrong. It turns out that the way you have to tune the cam is to have it at zero when it's at 45 degree angle. And that it took us a whole afternoon to figure that one out. And it's because we forgot that there was a differential and you have to add this constant thing to it, which means that you want the indicator to almost stop when you are at the maximum elongation over here at point B. And what happens, that happens when the linear part is being subtracted to the cam at exactly the same speed, and then it's zero. And it's a differential thing, so it is, so you actually have to have this kind of alignment where at the equator you want to be over here, and at 45 degrees, that's where you have to align it. You want the maximum or the minimum correction, depending on how you count it. Am I at zero? Yeah. So if I go at 45 over here, then on my cam down there, I am at the minimum of the cam. And once you do that, well, everything falls into place. You turn your globe and... No, we were on 135, and we're back on to 180, and now the whole thing works, and it only works if you fly along that 51 degree dot something. All right, we should be all repaired and ready for a time lapse of 7 orbits around the planet. Here we go. You can clearly see how the longitude indication is speeding up and slowing down in a complex way due to the cam correction. The black and white scale at the bottom is the daylight shadow indicator. Then on the left, the latitude, also calculated by a cam. To the right, the digital counter is the orbit counter. What a beautiful representation of space flight. Here is another view from a different angle. The globe now works beautifully, but we have one more thing to repair, the landing point indication, which makes use of the electronic relay board. Hopefully, we'll get that going in the next episode. See you then!